A healthy person normally absorbs about 1 to 2 milligrams of iron per day. But people with hemochromatosis absorb much more. This iron can build up in your body and cause problems if it is not treated. So in this video, I'll discuss everything you need to know about diet and hemochromatosis. If you're new here, welcome. I'm Maria and I'm a board certified dietitian in Ireland and Bermuda. And I'm here to help you understand nutrition and find a way of eating that works for you. So if that sounds good, please give the video a thumbs up and don't forget to subscribe by hitting the red subscribe button below as it really helps support the channel and it keeps me motivated to keep making more videos. So hemochromatosis, or otherwise known as iron overload, is an inherited disorder which causes the body to absorb too much iron from the diet. This excess iron gradually accumulates, usually in the liver, pancreas, joints, and heart. If you're in Ireland, it has the highest rate of hemochromatosis worldwide. 1 in 5 people are carriers of the gene, and 1 in 83 are at risk of developing the condition. I myself was diagnosed with this condition earlier this year, so it's something that lies very close to my heart. Comment below and let me know if you have hemochromatosis, you know somebody who does, or if it's something that you just never heard of before. Symptoms usually start around the ages of 30 to 40, and these can include things like headaches, weakness, joint pain, feeling very tired all of the time, and sometimes even weight loss. Some people might not have any symptoms for a very long period of time. So if you're at risk, which I'll discuss next, it's really important to get tested. Hemochromatosis is caused by a faulty gene that affects how your body absorbs iron. You can inherit hemochromatosis if both of your parents have the faulty gene, and you inherit one copy from each parent. You will not get hemochromatosis if you inherit only one copy, but there's a chance that you could pass the faulty gene onto any children that you might have in the future. And even if you do inherit 2 copies of the gene, you might not necessarily go on to develop the condition. In my example, my dad has hemochromatosis, but my mother does not. However, she carries the gene. I inherited a copy from both parents and went on to develop the condition. Some of my siblings also have the condition, but some of them don't. It can be confusing, so do speak to your GP about getting tested. And it's just a simple blood test, so there is no excuse. Now, there is no cure for hemochromatosis, but there are treatments that can reduce the amount of iron that builds up in your body and reduce the risk of damage. The treatment of choice and the most effective strategy is regular venesections or blood removal. It's similar to if you were going to a blood donor clinic and donating your blood. Depending on how much iron has built up, you might need to have quite a few venesections at the beginning, over the course of a few weeks. But then, usually when you get to maintenance levels, you only need to have this done every few months. Now, the role of diet. So it's really important to remember that diet cannot treat hemochromatosis. The main treatment is your blood removal. But because we do get some iron from food and drink, some changes can help to limit the amount of iron your body stores in between treatments. But to really get this point home, I want to share this image here. You can see the venesections have a huge impact. Diet changes can help, but they're not going to help enough to prevent an overload in the same way as the regular venesections can. But when it comes to iron in the diet, there are a number of things that we can think about. You can look at the amount of iron in your food, how easy or difficult it is for your body to absorb that iron, adding in foods that can reduce iron absorption, and avoiding or limiting foods that increase iron absorption. At the end of this video today, I'm also going to discuss common questions about iron and hemochromatosis. I'll look at alcohol, pregnancy, fortified foods, supplements, and vitamin C supplements, as well as a few other bits. So to start off, there is no need to cut out all foods that contain iron. It's an essential nutrient that you do still need to eat, even when you have hemochromatosis. Also, iron is found in lots of other foods that give your body other important nutrients. If you were to cut out all of these foods, you would have a very unbalanced diet. Now, we can look closer at foods, and we can look at the foods that have a lot of iron versus those that don't have as much. There is no need to completely avoid high iron foods, but it can be a good idea to limit how often you have them. Here, I have a list of the iron content in many common foods, but I have linked below in the description a really comprehensive booklet from the Irish Hemochromatosis Association that has a much more comprehensive list of foods. And it also has a lot of detail about what I'm covering today. So do check it out, and I'll add their website details below as well. So we can also think about how our body absorbs the iron in the food that we eat. In foods like meat, the iron is easily absorbed. In foods like spinach and lentils, your body has a bit more difficulty absorbing the iron. And this is because there are two different types of iron. We have heme iron and non-heme iron. So heme iron is found in meat, poultry and fish. And your body finds it very easy to absorb this type of iron. Whereas non-heme iron is found in eggs and plant foods, spinach, whole grains and lentils. And it is much more difficult for your body to absorb this type of iron. So eating more foods containing the non-heme iron over the heme iron may be a helpful strategy for people with hemochromatosis. We can also think about inhibitors. And these are foods that can help to prevent the absorption of iron. They work by either binding to the iron or competing with the iron for absorption. Eating these foods with or just after a meal may help to reduce the absorption of iron. So common inhibitors include phytates, found in nuts, seeds, beans, and lentils, and whole grains. And although some of these foods are sources of iron, the phytates in them reduce the iron absorption. Polyphenols, which include tannins found in tea and coffee. So great news if you're an avid tea drinker like me. And drinking tea or coffee with or just after meals can help reduce the iron absorption. Calcium-rich foods, like your milk and your yogurt, they may also help to reduce iron absorption as the calcium competes with the iron. Dietary fiber, so high fiber foods like whole grain bread, bran-based cereals, fruits and vegetables are all good sources of dietary fiber. And oxalates, which are found in green leafy vegetables like spinach, and in almonds, beetroot, berries, soy food, and rhubarb. So enhancers, on the other side of the scale, increase the amount of iron your body absorbs. So it's best to avoid eating these foods or nutrients when you are eating foods with iron, as this will help to reduce the amount of iron you're absorbing. Enhancers include things like fructose, which is found mainly in fruit juices. So try to limit fruit juices to 150 ml per day and have them 1 hour before or after your meals. Alcohol, so limit alcohol, but I'll cover that in more detail in a few moments. And vitamin C supplements. So it's best to avoid these, but if you do need to take them, make sure you're having them again 1 hour before or after your meals. Fruit and vegetables are also a source of vitamin C, which enhances iron absorption, but we don't need to worry about this because they also contain the fiber, so it counteracts each other. Moving on to alcohol. Alcohol is a common concern for people with hemochromatosis, and rightly so. We already know that drinking too much alcohol can have an impact on our overall health and well-being. But when you have genetic hemochromatosis, the effects of alcohol can be even greater. And this is because alcohol itself is an enhancer, so it increases the amount of iron available and absorbed from food. Alcohol can also damage liver and heart health, which are key organs that can be affected by iron overload. As most of us know, alcohol puts a lot of pressure on our liver. And finally, and quite surprising, is that alcohol itself is a source of iron. To put it into perspective, you will often get more iron from a glass of wine than you will get from eating a chicken breast. And cider in particular is very high in iron. If you become pregnant, of course, inform your doctor and all of the medical staff involved in taking care of you that you have hemochromatosis. There are lots of changes to how our body handles iron during pregnancy. So it's important to address this with your doctor for individual advice. Do continue to eat a healthy diet and to limit foods that are very high in iron, as well as iron supplements, to make sure that they don't contain iron. Many prenatal supplements will have this added. Often, venesections are paused during pregnancy, as you do need larger amounts of iron for both you and the developing baby. But again, speak with your doctor, because women with hemochromatosis can become iron deficient during pregnancy, especially if you're experiencing a lot of nausea and vomiting. And follow the advice of your doctor or your dietitian if you do find that you are low in iron. Naturally, if you have hemochromatosis, you don't need to be taking any iron supplements. And many people take supplements without realizing what is in them. So check the labels, ask your doctor or ask your dietitian. Before I was diagnosed, I was actually taking a multivitamin that had iron in it without even realizing that I was doing damage. So make sure that you know what you're taking and why. A lot of general female multivitamins and supplements will contain iron in them, so be sure to check the label. This is a random one, but people with hemochromatosis need to avoid raw shellfish, like oysters, mussels, and clams. and this is because they can become contaminated with a bacteria called Vibrio vulnificus. It's like a Harry Potter spell. But this type of bacteria relies on iron for growth, so it thrives in people affected with iron overload, and it can cause an infection that can be fatal. Always cook your shellfish at a high temperature, and if handling any raw shellfish, always wash your hands well with soap and water, as the bacteria can get onto your skin. Many foods today have vitamins and minerals added into them during processing. An example of this is many breakfast cereals have iron added in, because iron is actually a common deficiency worldwide. But for people with hemochromatosis, it can be wise to limit foods that are fortified with iron. So check labels where possible. If you're struggling, don't worry too much, but just avoid having something like an iron fortified cereal with a glass of orange juice. Hydrate. Plenty of water before and after your venesection. This can help improve your blood flow. And don't skip breakfast if you're doing it in the morning. A quick 10-minute walk can also help to get your blood pumping beforehand. Make sure to have something to drink and a snack after, and avoid vigorous exercise for 24 hours after your venesection. It's also usually helpful to wear loose clothing and a few layers, as you can become quite cold when your blood has been drained. I can speak from experience. I hope you found this video useful. Please comment below and let me know what stood out to you the most. And if you have a hemochromatosis story, I'd love to hear it. But make sure to give the video a like, and don't forget to subscribe so you don't miss any of my future videos. And thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you next week.